This is a method for restoring ideal tone and performance response to a double reed which has either never had it because when it was newly created it didn't have the best piece of cane perhaps, or a reed that might have been playing well originally but has lost some of its bright tone and easy response. The method is based on taking the reed apart and resurfacing the interior to restore a very smooth, perfectly curved interior all the way from the very tip end of the reed down into about the middle of the blade or so. And each cylinder is a slightly different size, and they each are used over a different short range so that we recreate a new surface over again over all the areas where the reed vibrates and closes together and comes apart. Now we're going to test the reed in the chanter and see how it sounds and responds. Those are the sounds of a reed that is resistant and somewhat dull in the tone. That's caused by warping of the cane. And so what we'll do is we'll take the reed apart and we'll inspect the interior, look to see where the damage is, and we'll give it a resurfacing job and try to restore the maximum tone and easy response and loud volume that we want from a concert reed. The photograph shows the interior of a reed blade, and the black lines drawn across the inside of it are meant to illustrate the curvature from one side to the next. And as you can see, going from the right side towards the left side where the tails are, the curvature of the inside of the reed increases gradually. This is what we'll be looking for when we take the reed apart and inspect each of its two blades for the curvature or irregularities in those curvatures. Here you can see a setup to illustrate the process of inspecting the inside of a reed. This is on a much larger scale. I've got a light that creates a very harsh side light to shine across the surface that we want to inspect. And what we will do when we inspect the reed is we're going to tilt the surface across the direction of the light, and that is going to allow us to see very tiny changes in the surface texture and the curvature, particularly out at the edges of the blades. This image of the inside of a reed shows what we're going to be looking for when we take our reed apart and inspect it. If you look up at the top, the arrows indicate the direction that side light is shining across the surface almost exactly parallel to the surface so that we can magnify the visibility of any curvatures and roughness that might be harming the tone of the reed. At the top, you can see the top edge of the reed is somewhat light. It should not be. If that was a complete concave curve, as the rest of the reed is, the surface would get increasingly dark as you go to the top, and the very top edge would be the darkest of all. The fact that it gets light again indicates that it's bent back outwards again, and light is able to fall on a surface that should be hidden from it. Just below that, it's very dark, and that indicates a section of surface that has dipped inwards away from the light a little bit unnaturally. And so those kinds of features give us an idea of a surface that's irregular and one that we can smooth out with a resurfacing process. So now let's take a look at the reed and we'll see what we have with our actual reed. Well, here's the reed with the light shining on it from the side, as indicated by my pencil here. In this section, you can see a clear, simple, pure concave curve. It's the lightest over on this side, and it gets darker and darker, and the darkest part is over on the left side there. But if we look up at the lips, we see a different pattern. And I'm going to move the light back and forth so that you can see it shaded differently. If I move the light back out this way, you'll notice that it only gets dark for a while here, but the extreme edge down into here is actually lighter than just inside. And if we look, when I shade it more, put more of it in the shade there, instead of getting lighter and lighter all the way to the right edge, you see the right edge for about the middle up is actually darker than the part closer in. So what that means is that both edges have bent backwards slightly as a result of the pressure of being bound up into a reed and then settling. And so this is what's causing that dull tone and that resistant response that we heard. And this is actually a pretty severe case. The other blade I've looked at is not quite as badly warped. I'm not sure if this is rescuable or not, but we'll try it and we'll see what we get for results. Part of our initial examination is to check for thin spots in the reed so that we know areas that we can't sand very much. If you look, the reed on the left has some thin spots showing up at the tip. This one on the right, this blade is a lot thicker, and so we can do quite a bit of sanding in there if we need to. But with this one, we have to be very careful out by the tip not to go through that. The other thing we need to check in the beginning and as we go along is the thickness of the edge. Now I've shown the light off at an angle here, and hopefully you can see a little white line there indicating there is some thickness on that edge. You may have to use magnification, but look carefully at the edges and look for any thin spots, especially up near the corners, which again indicate areas that you have to be very careful with when you're resurfacing. For reeds that are already scraped and either new or that have been in service, we need to use cylinders for sanding that are quite wide. So you can see these are over 10 centimeters wide. I have various sizes here, a very wide one and increasingly narrow cylinders down to 3 or 4 centimeters or even less. And what we'll do first is we'll take a look at the lips and we will try to find which of these cylinders is the best match for the curvature at the lips, because that's the most critical. So we have to have a very close match on that so that we're just lightly reshaping irregularities and not trying to change the shape, which could run the risk of sanding parts of it far too thin. The graphic indicates what we're trying to do. The dotted line indicates the sanding cylinder, and the warped black heavy line there, that's the blade that we're trying to resurface. In this case, it's got a dip over towards the left side and a bit of an arch towards the middle, and we don't want the sanding cylinder's diameter to deviate too much from a middle line across that so that we don't have too big a gap in the middle and we might not sand that down to the final curve, or we have too much contact at the far side where the little dip is and we could cut too much of that away. In either case, we would have a reed that wouldn't perform very well. Looking here at the sides of the reed, up at the lips, you can see the extreme warping right near the edges, and this shows where we have to try to cut into the cane first with our resurfacing. This diagram also shows that it's the trough just inside of the edge, and but not into the center. We want to cut that trough away first, and now I'll show you how we go about doing that. We start resurfacing by sanding the lips of the reed first using the biggest cylinder that has the best match to the curvature. Ordinarily, if the warping is not very severe, we use an in and out sanding motion, holding the reed flat and pressing very lightly so that only areas that are warped get sanded away, and it gradually then cuts back the parts that protrude into the blade until they're smooth and in a continuous curve with the rest of the blade. We sand just a few strokes at a time, and then we're going to check it under the light as I showed earlier. Only a little comes off at any given moment, but we don't want to cut too deeply because we can weaken the blade. However, this blade is much more warped than average, and so we use a different technique here. What I'm going to do is
is I'm going to sand off the edge of the sandpaper and back on repeatedly. And I'm going to concentrate on one side of the blade. And then having done that, I'll come and do the other side of the blade the same way, concentrating on the other edge. And that's because if you remember seeing the curvature of this blade, there were little protrusions just inside of the edges. And we want to sand those away without cutting the edges away or cutting away too much of the other material. When we see that the curvature is mostly restored, we then return to the conventional method of in and out sanding along the grain to finish up.
All right, let's try sanding. I've done the one edge, now I'll do the other. I'm holding the reed flat and using gentle pressure. I'm trying to contact the entire surface. I don't want to tip it one way or another. I'm just going to let the technique cut the hump out of the surface. I'm not going to try to force it by bending the cane or twisting it in any way. Now I'll take an inspection of it and see what it looks like. Okay, let's look at the reed with side light, harsh side light. I'm first going to look at the left side surface. When I move the light back and forth, it appears to me there's more curve in the center and there's a section that's flat. It's no longer humped. It has been worn down. But I don't think I have quite the same curvature here yet. I need to have it a little more steeper curvature inside the edge, but the edge is no longer bent out, so that's good. If you look down here, the edge is still bent out because I haven't worked on that section yet with an appropriate sized cylinder. Well, let's look at the other edge. At the other edge, it's very hard to see. I can't get enough magnification on this camera, but it's good from the center all the way near to the edge, but there's just the tiniest little reverse curvature at the edge left, and of course quite a bit down here. We'll go down there later. So I'm going to put it back, and I'm going to work mostly on this left edge and try to restore just a little more curve yet. The rest of it's looking very good.
Since I had almost perfected the upper interior curve using the sideways sanding method, I'm finishing up now with the in-and-out method, flat on the cylinder, very low pressure. And now we're going to move on to the other cylinders to go deeper into the interior. And we use a different method for each of those, which I'll show you shortly. For all of the narrower cylinders, we can't hold the reed flat on the sandpaper because it would interfere with the curve that we had established further outwards. So what I'm going to do is sand on the edge of the cylinder like this, tilt it up slightly at a few degrees, and I'm going to come from around 3 to 5 millimeters in from the tip, and I'll sand over an area of about 10 millimeters, but I've got to be very careful not to damage the smooth surface that I've established out at the lips. That's why I'm tipping it up. So from about 3 to 5, for a range of 10 millimeters.
All right, we'll sand a few strokes, and then we'll check the interior. All right, I'll move the light around to the side. And now I can see underneath the shallow curve of the lips, the next curve down is a little bit tighter, and it goes from edge to edge, so I've done enough. When you go too low with a cylinder, it will start to leave contact with the middle, and you can see that there's more flat down here lower than there is up here. This is about where it leaves contact. So then I'll take the next cylinder, the third one, and I'll overlap that about halfway so that maybe 5 millimeters or so. I had sanded the second one in this range, so I'll overlap it a little bit and then take it down a little farther. And the other thing we do is we check the edges for signs that the cylinder, as it got lower at the lower end of its range, begins to dig into the edge. That we have to avoid. There's not enough magnification to show that adequately here.
But that's the lower end of each cylinder is what we have to watch for eroding the edges, and we have to let that determine exactly how deep we can take each cylinder. All right, let's examine the reed. I've used four cylinders through it, starting from the widest cylinder at the tip to the narrowest cylinder a little past halfway down the open portion of the blades. So if I move the light out and come around to the side, the first thing you can see is there's a very nice, crisp, concave shape going all the way to the left edge and all the way to the right edge at the top. But if we get further down here, you can see in this region on the left, there's still too much light showing, and the darkness occurs just inside it, but doesn't go all the way to the edge as it's supposed to, as it does up here. And the similar problem is on the right edge. There it gets dark a little too early. If we look at the tip and I fade the light out, it stays light to the very end. But here, the outer edge gets dark early, and that means there's still some reverse curvature. So I'm going to take the bottom two, maybe three cylinders, and work the center zone a little bit more. I'll be cutting a little more material away from the center of the cane to bring the curvature out just to touching the edge. I won't cut into the edge until I've brought the concave curve all the way out exactly to it, and that's the point which I have to be very careful to stop sanding so that I don't thin the edges too much. All right, I'll move the light around to the side and we'll inspect the curvature of the inside of the reed. And now you can see that the shadow starts at the extreme edge of the left, and as I move the light back, it progresses smoothly right across, and it fades out on the right edge very uniformly all the way up and down in the top, about two-thirds of the interior distance of the open space of the head. The mark here indicates the top of the staple, and so I've not sanded, you can tell, in this area down here at the bottom, but all this other section has been reworked, and these edges will flex together and apart wherever they're supposed to contact in a very regular manner. So I'll now do the other blade, and then we'll put the reed back together and we'll try it. All right, I've bound the reed together and I've put the bridle on it, and let's give it a couple of quick tests. First, we'll test the crow. I've opened it up very slightly, a little bit more than I usually like for playing, because I want to hear a particular thing. And that lower harmonic that comes in with a gentle increase in the pressure of inhalation is a marker of a reed that's got a nice response to it. I'll close it down to my playing elevation and we'll test it in the chanter. And there is a very bright, responsive chanter reed. It sounds nothing like it did when we began, when it was still warped, and that's an example of how dramatic a rescue you can make to a reed. And I've only pulled a tiny amount of sawdust out over the entire operation on both blades. It's just a matter of getting a right surface shape, and that reed is going to respond very well. This one is a new reed. I haven't finished thinning it down all the way, and it has some exterior adjustments left to go, all of the usual ones. But it is well on its way to being a very good sounding reed, and I may sell it to somebody.